VIP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art issues with three guests and the host, James Carroll. Home viewers are invited to call and offer comments or questions during the live telecast. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hi, this is Ron Shire with the New Arts Program Connection here. I'm sitting in for James Carroll, and I have two guests with me tonight. On my right, I have Nancy Segetti, who is a mosaic artist and a ceramicist and a painter and a number of different artistic productions. And to my left, I have Matthew Hamilton, who is a ceramic artist, a potter, and a conceptual artist. So we're going to be speaking about ceramic and mosaic as a creative art form. So hi. Hi, guys.
Hi, Ron.
How are you?
Hi, Ron. I'm good. How are you?
Okay. Well, here we go. I just wanted to discuss, you know, the different art forms that you guys are using, because mosaic and ceramic have generally been known as decorative and stained glass and such things as used as functional inside of your home. And with pottery and plates and stuff, they would look at it more as something that's utilitarian, that you would have a you put food on it or drink out of it or something. But I'm thinking of this in a way where it's used more as a creative tool, for aesthetic appreciation than functional. So I was wondering if I could get your opinions and thoughts on what you do as artists, and then we'll show some documentation of your work. Who wants to go first?
Well, I think everybody goes through phases.
Yeah.
And my current phase right now is taking utilitarian items and decorating them as non-functional anymore items, such as shoes, chair, things that were formerly utilitarian, formerly of use other than as an art piece,
right,
turning them into an art piece. I think I've been through different phases with that. When I first started out, I was making whimsical people and animal sort of things,
mm-hmm.
and then I went into actual functional pieces, and now I'm taking functional pieces and making them more aesthetic.
Right, and it's not like you've done some birdhouses, and it's different kinds of adaptations of homes for animals, like dog houses and things. And you've also taken non-mosaic items like sawhorses and things of that nature, and created actual animals out of them. And one of the pieces I remember from your show at the Humane Society actually was a couple of pieces of wood that were tacked onto a wall with some rope and some string.
Oh, yes, that was all found pieces of wood. I went out one day and said, I'm going down to the dock because there's some things down there I need, and brought back what I could find and put together some characters.
So some of your technique applies to found objects as well, too.
Yes,
so you're taking
very
time.
Much so, yes. Mm-hmm. Or I go around and scrounge off of other artists, scrounge off of glass blowers. Castaways.
Well, there's a number of people doing this right now. I mean, like Elise Arnold, Ben Sharp, Nate Dubs, they're all working at this kind of newfound way of producing art that's not associated with traditional form. Say like painting. Like painting has been really heavily beleaguered in the last 50 years or so. And I was wondering, you had said to me, Matt, one time about...
Wait, before...
Okay.
One thing. Did you do sculpture with sawhorses?
Yes.
Oh, sweet. I like that.
I made horses.
Okay, that's great. I would like to see those. But to clarify something you were saying before when you were, I mean, kind of talking about Nancy's work as far as Mosaic, and then referring to it in, like talking about stained glass. Actually, historically, at the times those things were being produced, they were the epitome of high art. And so we're going back to
churches
something.
And,
yeah, exactly. There was no higher art form than
stained glass.
I mean, it's much bigger than painting. I mean, it was a light show. It was something fantastic, and it was immersing people in something. Mm-hmm. So it was never like stained glass wasn't ever decorative. It is now. We think of it now, but historically, at that point, it was high tech art. It was the highest form of art, much higher than painting was.
Mosaics also were.
Exactly, and prior to that, mosaics were the most immersive form of art.
Well, I guess maybe I'm referring to 20th century.
Yeah.
Yeah, instead of going back, into the major, when they were building the Renaissance churches and such.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a different historical. I think maybe I'm concentrating mostly on the 20th century modernist.
Okay, I just wanted to check that.
I know, but I'm glad you did. Because I like to know the whole story. But
so now, what was you were going to grill me with some questions.
Well, you had said once to me that, painting was not about art to you. And that you were more influenced by other art forms and that they meant more to you than painting. That painting was not art to you.
I painting wasn't a viable thing. It was mm-hmm. it had become the kind of the equivalent of what the way we talk about stained glass or mosaic, which I mean there was a time when painting was vitally important, and I don't think historically in where we are now, I don't think painting is that, it's not that intriguing to me. And I mean, part of it is generational, like we've talked about, that I grew up in a certain time, and as a kid, I was like, I didn't want to be a painter. I was like, I want to be an artist. What does an artist do? Mm-hmm. And I looked at the cover of Art Forum, or Art in America, or I guess Art News back then, and it wasn't a painting on the on the cover. An artist didn't do paintings, an artist did conceptual artwork. And that's how I became an artist. I mean, that's what my reference was. It wasn't a painting.
Right.
I looked at painting because that was happening then, but it wasn't the expression that an artist made. I wouldn't be an artist. I didn't want to be a painter.
You didn't find that it was applicable to the times. It didn't really fit.
It was part of my generation. It didn't make sense that I would say I was a painter because that seemed so limited and it seemed old-fashioned.
Well, I definitely have to agree that painting has lost its edge over the last 20 years or so.
The art market keeps like pulling it back in and making it, when art is strictly a commodity, then painting keeps being valid. And for better or worse, I don't know. I mean, I still don't. I don't think of painting as particularly noble in and of itself as a pursuit. I believe art is a pursuit that's, for better or worse, I like it, and I like looking at it, and I like thinking about it, and I like talking about it. But painting itself isn't better than anything else.
I think painting's somewhat fallen into a kind of a stasis right at the moment. It hasn't really progressed too far. I mean, we have a few good people out there, but it's not really like they've hit the Eureka zone yet.
I don't know if it ever will. I mean, I don't think art ever is solved. There's never a finally thing. Put down your brushes, people. Painting's been solved.
Yeah.
Because there's photography. There's always going to be installation. There's always going to be sculpture. There's always going to be mosaic. There's always going to be stained glass. There's all those things are always going to keep happening. It's just how you use those things. But painting itself as an end, just I don't get it.
Yeah.
I mean, I get it. I know good painting.
You get it, but you don't.
But I'm like,
not your thing. Mm-mm. That's cool. Well, we have some video documentation. We're gonna start off with Nancy's work first. Can we put that on and we can speak over top of it? And this is in your studio. This is in the Mosaic Studio at 522 Penn Avenue there.
Some little tiles, some little clay places. This piece that we're coming onto now is going to be my first attempt at smoke firing. I'm interested now for the first time really in the glazes and the outer colorings with clay.
Is that greenware?
It is a low fire red clay. And that...
Has that been bisque?
It's bisque fired.
Okay.
And that is some copper carbonate that I put on there. This is a mailbox and some kitchen table legs that I turned into a horse with wings. Most of my creatures end up having wings. I think that's the first sawhorse horse.
That's a neat. That's great. Okay, and you also produce mobiles here.
Stuff playing around with a mobile piece. That's a picture of my nephew's oldest daughter in a bottle cap, and just stuck on that little canvas there.
We have a very positive sort of, life-enriching way of looking at things too, because you have some things that say things like tenderness and what does that say? Effort is the...
It's not the problem, it's the solution.
Solution, yes. Now there's the shoes that you were speaking about. Yeah.
Otto Mille Fiori, I call them. 8,000 flowers, 4,000 pieces of glass on each. Approximately 4,000 pieces of glass in each shoe.
Yeah.
With astroturf inside.
Incredibly.
That's also a historical term as far as bead making, isn't it?
The Mille Fiori is, those are pieces that are not bead shaped, they're more flat, but Mille Fiori is 1,000 flowers, and they are Italian pieces of glass.
And these are some of your clay sculptures?
Yes.
Oh, these are all animals, and these are just all hand-molded.
These are all, little pieces.
Mm-hmm.
It's a jar. I like to mix, different, maybe unexpected pieces, a jar and a little statue and some teacups. That was the first piece I ever made. After many years of not knowing what to do with clay beyond making tiles, I just never made any sense to me until I went to do this piece.
The tall one.
It's a silly jar. Everything has a face or wings or, even when I was a kid first starting to draw, I would, draw a table, but it would have a head on it, or draw a pencil, but it would have a head and feet on it.
Mm-hmm. I really like these.
Studies
really,
just in white, or variations of white. With no grout. I'm liking the mosaic form without grout. It's letting the light come through.
I'm really impressed by your, your labor-intensive production here.
I
mean, everything
that.
Is...
Why this is a good medium for me, because I love tedious, intense, just hunkering down and zoning in and, finding the right piece that fits. It's a lot like doing a puzzle to me when you look down and you... Because a lot of times I do look down and there's a piece that I had just randomly cut and it fits exactly into the space, so...
So you work these spontaneously. You don't really put them.
Yeah, I never. I might draw out like the center figure of a piece, and then everything else around it is just as I go.
Now have you always worked intuitively?
Yes, always. I've never studied it. I have no desire to. beyond curiosity, if, you know, I started making mosaics because I dropped a tile one day, and that's literally how I started. I was meant to tile, and it didn't make any sense to me, and then a tile fell on the floor, and then I started mosaicing. And if I had been doing that a number of years, you know, then I started to, you know, do some reading about the history. This is a floor piece that will go outside in the front of somebody's home. I did it in my studio on that mesh.
What are the materials on there?
It's all glass, and the gold is gold glass.
Mm-hmm. And it's sturdy enough and strong enough to walk on.
Here's Ron's favorite.
Oh, I love these things. these ladders. Can you pause on this for a second?
Wow, those are really nice. Yeah, those are beautiful.
I started painting sticks. Mm-hmm. I don't know why I started. After a rainstorm one day, I was taking a walk, and there were all these interesting sticks, and I, you know, had a handful of them, and I took them back to my studio, and, you know, everything's about color to me, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And so I painted up these sticks, and then after I painted them, I put little polka dots on them, because I really like polka dots. And these came later. I used to have some frogs in my studio, and I made my first ladder as a little toy for the frogs to, you know, climb up in their terrarium. And then it got bigger.
I think they're really...
Not the frogs.
Yeah, the ladders. But I think they're really interesting. I mean, I think they're an interesting form. And,
they fit. Then when I had a few shows and I started placing them around, and then somebody said to me, "What is the significance of that?" And I said, "So the animals can get up and down off the pedestals." But people were also, you know, it's interesting what the artist thinks they're doing in their work, and then what other people think they're doing in their work, and then, you know, people start talking about a higher source, a higher power, spirituality. And I said, well, yeah, you know, I definitely connect to all that when I'm doing my work, so.
Right. Well, I agree with that, because I think that the ladders have a metaphorical significance as well, too. I mean, you can see them as a climbing, as a reaching, as a goal of some sort that you're going to, you know, but
I'm
always
interested,
like,
in that kind of thing. Yeah. Or wings for freedom all the time, on my people, on my horses, on my animals. I try to be uplifting when I'm doing my work. Not that I don't appreciate political art, or, you know, maybe some more dark, intense art. I can appreciate that, but myself, I feel that, like, we're so serious and intense in our lives in this world so much of the time, that any like little light piece of air that I can bring into a little space is a good idea.
Well, it's conjoining. It's life affirming. It brings people together. And we're isolated. The whole society is isolated. You know, which is a sad thing, actually, but. You know, I think that that's maybe one of the purposes of the art, of art, is to bring people together, to create thought, to create conversation, to make people, you know, discuss things that, you know, are important.
Yes, and I always enjoy hearing what other people think that I've done. Because quite often it's not what I thought I've done at all, but it's interesting, you know. It's interesting to hear.
Well, I've always thought that you can never really trust what an artist says about their own work.
Mm.
You know, you have to look at it, you know, from your own personal viewpoint.
What's the scale of those ladders? How large are they?
I think maybe the largest one might be, so far, some of that I have put away in a barn might be like 7 feet.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Might be 7.
And it's all made out of twigs?
They're all, well, some of them are, you know, as big as this around. And I had originally took them to Penn State when I had a show there. I was going to line them up along the wall, and it wasn't working out the way I had pictured it in my mind. And the next thing I knew, I was just, you know, I had the materials I start right there on the floor as we were putting the show together. I made these ladders.
So are they lashed together?
They're lashed together with different...
That's a beautiful idea. I hadn't seen
it. Well,
seen
it was
before.
Neat because it just came, it just, you know, I hadn't planned it at all. At all. And it just, it worked out really well.
I'm going to steal that idea. No, because I do a lot of work with sticks, too.
Oh.
And but I like that, because I do a lot of lashing, but I also do, like, bundling. But I like that idea of making more...
Well, give up some of your stuff here. Let me...
Okay, can we continue with the disc, please?
Yeah, they're beautiful, Nancy. Wow.
You know, these are what I was referring to earlier, is the painterly quality of these mosaic pieces that are wall-hanging pieces. And they definitely step outside of the rectangular unit that comprises painting. I really like this one because it has this wavy sort
That's
of
clay
mountainous.
And glass. It's clay, stained glass, and Italian smalti glass.
Yeah, like each one of these.
And then I put words in there sometimes. That one to the left has some sort of... This was the first piece I did, one of two pieces, experimenting with outdoor usable materials for a piece to be outdoors all the time in these weather conditions that we have here, other than cement. My studio is up on the second floor, and I have a very narrow hallway you have to walk through with everything, so I was looking for some lighter weight materials.
And you do painting as well, too, so I noticed that. I don't have too many examples of your paintings in this, but you do acrylics and, you know, and kind of woven work.
Mixed media. Sometimes I sew on there. Sometimes I just put glass right on the, in with the paint.
That one's interesting.
That was a study on the face. Mirrors. This is the mirrors. Are very popular.
Yeah.
Because they're utilitarian, so people can justify having a piece of artwork sometimes if it's utilitarian. This one's about my second visit to India. I was inspired by...
Yeah, can we pause here just to take a look at some of the detail on this? Because you did visit India at one point. You went to Chandigarh?
Chandigarh was the first place I went in northern India and at the Punjab to visit a mosaic artist there who, an accidental mosaic artist. He was some guy that was just in the forest for 14 years in secret making things, which later on turned out to be mosaics, and he made them out of broken toilets and sinks and things. And after 14 years, he was discovered, and you know, everybody said, "Wow, you know, you're really some hot stuff, and we're going to give you a salary and 50 employees." And now he has 25 acres of mosaics, but he's really a humble guy. It's the second most visited site in the country. Anyway,
what's the first?
Taj Mahal.
Oh, I figured, yeah.
I went there thinking that I was volunteering to pick up trash, but the hopes of just like maybe running into him and you know, meeting him, and it ended up being quite a different experience altogether.
His name is that was Nek Chan, right?
Nek Chan, right?
Yeah. So you did meet him, and you did. He kind of like take you under his belt, or.
I just honestly was going to be happy picking up trash, and I got there, and he wanted me to make a mosaic, and I didn't even get it. You know, they were saying, now the expert is here, we can make a mosaic, and I honestly was looking around to see who was here, that we were going to do this thing, and it was really hard, because, you know, I sit in my little studio with my pink glass and my red glass. I mean, I cut it all and everything, but, you know, everything's right there at my reach, and now they were, like, just dumping this garbage, and we had to pick through it. We only had five colors to make a 30-foot long by 7 feet high, and I'm so color-oriented, that felt kind of restricting, you know, to get a picture out of five colors.
Am I mistaken, or was... when his work first got like kind of came to the forefront and people knew about it, it was originally going to be destroyed.
It was going to be destroyed.
Yeah.
He had.
Could you tell that story? I think that's
could,
really
yeah, interesting. Yeah, he was making all the stuff in secret in the jungle at the edge of the village, and he was going around collecting. They destroyed 23 villages, and he was collecting all the trash and the rubble from that and making things out of it, and only simply for his own pleasure. Mm-hmm. I said to him, what moved you to do that? And he said, it was a hobby, you know, just, he was just experimenting. And for 2 years, his wife didn't even know he was doing it. Seriously, 14 years, he just was doing it until some, they were clearing brush at the side of the, and they discovered him. And then all of a sudden it was like, woo. He says, I'm not an artist. I just, you know, was pursuing my hobby. Mm-hmm. You know, so that was like, I really was drawn to him because of that. Because he, you know, I just loved that. He just was doing it. It was just coming out of his heart and soul, and he just was playing around and.
Mm-hmm. Not like the professional preconceived artist that is floating around the streets of New York and Chicago.
For anything, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so he's kind of the equivalent of what we think of in an urban environment as a street artist. You know, someone
yeah, he
flaming,
was. Yes, he was. Mm-hmm. And he would, and on his bicycle, he was like, you know, he used old bicycles to, and it's really very ingenious, the pieces. Mm-hmm. Very ingenious.
Yeah, totally agreed. I think
I just wanted to be in the atmosphere, mm-hmm. so, you know, mm-hmm. while I was there, I got to live right mm-hmm. at the rock garden, you know. So I just wanted to be absorbed by mm-hmm. by all of that, just living with it.
Well, that topic of the artist that creates because he has to has mm-hmm. been coming up quite a lot lately.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that those artists are actually the ones that stand the test of time. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have a lot of artists that have gone to school, studied art, but their goals are totally different. You know, they're looking at, well, I want to be immortal. I want to be remembered. I want to be the next Picasso. And all of that is just kind of secondary to really what.
Yeah, well, I think a lot of times when you have that in mind, then you sort of are creating for the public, creating, mm-hmm. you know, what's the in thing that, you know, oh, people are really into mauve this year. Let's mm-hmm. do everything in mauve.
Sensationalism. You know, that whole situationist thing. Well, that's.
Well, is that necessarily better or worse than creating for your own, you know, satisfaction?
No.
Better or worse?
No. Well, it's a different kind of artist is what it is. You know, it's a different kind of personality. You know, it's a symptom of the society. You know, I mean, we all want to be noticed inside of this culture, so.
Well, I think it's a matter of being dictated by the outside rather than being dictated by the inside.
Yeah.
You know. Better, worse, right, wrong? No, just coming from a different place.
Different mm-hmm. place. Mm-hmm. But sometimes those artists that are college trained and supposedly professional artists, they're looking. They're not making something because it's coming out of their heart. They're going through you know, a bunch of formulas and art history and what was done before, what hasn't been done, what am I doing in order to, you know, bring this to the fore. Seems that it's a little bit more forced. Somebody like Nick Chan or, you know, a naive artist, you know, will be coming out with it, you know, spontaneously, mm-hmm. Naturally, mm-hmm. you know, kind of a lot easier.
You gave me no time to think about it either. It's like, have some chalk, I'll draw on the wall, make
yep,
something.
Get something, yep. Mm-hmm. So, okay, let's continue with the video.
This is an Italian glass, a couple different forms, a millefiori, mm-hmm. little round flowery pieces, and then the other pieces are the smalti, what they use in the, what's in all the old churches, when it's like 200 feet up in the air and there's no electricity in there and it's still sparkling and shimmering mm-hmm. because of their formula that they use. It's enamel-like.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's the ceiling fan going.
Yep.
How'd you get that animation in there?
Cool, huh?
Wow.
Hey, I don't have to tell you all my secrets.
See, I like that. I like that sort of temple ziggurat feeling there. Now, you also do decorate. Oh, there's that one that I was
That's
thinking about.
That's the one I made from the junk. I went down to the dock. I said to this kid that was helping me one summer, come on, we're going down to the dock. He said, what for? I said, I don't know. There's stuff down there on the dock that I just needed to make something. And there was this wood.
So you put a vest on the piece of wood there.
Yes. I got a little mosaic. That's porcelain in the center.
I like
porcelain
that one.
Porcelain and glass.
Like that.
Non-color. I go from like lots of color to non-color sometimes.
There's plenty of color in that, actually.
Well, around the edges, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, on this one here, yeah.
This is a kind of a new direction I'm going
that
in.
That sounds like that.
That one doesn't have any grout. I'm kind of liking no grout.
So how do you fix the tiles?
Well, there's different kind of adhesive depending on if it's indoor or outdoor.
Mm-hmm.
I have a whole cabinet full of adhesives.
Okay.
You know, is it going to get wet? Is it in the bathroom? Is it on the floor? Is it inside? Is it outside?
These
That's
little Arab
a sample
desk,
for a
yeah.
church mm-hmm. piece I got a commission to
That's
do.
Nice.
That's the first time I used smaltio, a replica of a Byzantine piece. It's got a little drawing in it there. Let's put those under glass. This is grouted.
Okay, now.
There you go.
Okay, now we're over at Matthew's
crap.
Show. Over at Reading Industrial Art, over at Robbie Pepper's Gallery over there. And this is your show over there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, each of these have titles.
No, they that doesn't really matter.
Yeah. And that, these actually are rattles, is that correct? Like this, can
are
we pause on this one?
Are these smoke fired? Is that smoke?
Yeah, they're pit fired. And most of the finishes are using oxides.
Okay, can we pause on this one? Now this one's a reference, has a reference to Dr. Seuss.
Yeah.
Right, and why did you choose?
Just as the forms were building themselves, I was, I didn't realize how fond I was of Dr. Seuss until I was making these. And I was like, boy, these are starting to look really Seuss-y. So I just went with it.
Dr. Seuss is kind of wacky to begin with.
Yeah, so I didn't, and I'd never really thought about him, you know, artistically. I thought of him as a kid, and, you know, and then I was building these things, and I was like, boy, these are kind of, they're reminding me of something. Like, it's Dr. Seuss, really. And so I had to go into storage and find my old books that my dad gave me as a kid. And sure enough, I was like, oh, yeah, there's Dr. Seuss in there.
Very interesting.
Well, so I would kind of like to do some more of those things, because I enjoyed doing them. It's just like, it's just coil building, which is the simplest, you know, really ancient thing, but
you're just building like a one string of.
No, you make multiple coils and just join them together and just keep building, you know, in a circular fashion. And they were fun to make, and I think they're kind of fun to look at.
Oh, they're great.
And you know, once the Dr. Seuss thing hit my head, I was like, oh, okay, now I get it. I know what I was supposed to be doing.
That's interesting. I find that quite often, too. Sometimes I say that everything I do, I was doing when I was 5 years old. It's just doing it in a different way.
Mm-hmm. It was like I was making these things, and I didn't realize what was going on. And then once I was like, Dr. Seuss, I was like, oh, okay, yeah, of course it is.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, keep going. That's what you're doing. Yeah. And then, but then I stopped doing that once I realized it. So I don't know if it would be forced now, if I would be, am I intentionally going in that direction? So I, you know, most things, like when I solved the thing I was looking for, I just like, I'm done and just like move on.
Well, you may have been. Well, I remember you saying how much fun you were having when you first did these, that maybe you were like reverting to some sort of childhood desire. Hey,
what kind of glaze is that? Is that glaze?
The red one is iron oxide. The green one was a glaze, and it was both iron oxide on the white and the other tall one.
Can we pause on this one too?
Oxide.
Okay. Now these here were all like hand molded pieces of clay that you had just had fired and had them all facing in a circle together. Mm-hmm. So there's a conceptual tilt going on here that sort of has like a circle of hands, a joining of energies. What were your thoughts when you put this one together?
Well, no, I mean, the first couple I made were just trifles. You know, they were. Mm-hmm. I had a little lump of clay, and I had a minute, and I was just like, "Yeah, just form something." Mm-hmm. So I just formed something, and I made it, and then I was like, "Well, that's actually kind of nice, mm-hmm. just for nothing." You know, I liked it, but it was nothing. And then, like the second and third one, I was like, "Oh, well, you know, make something that complements that." And then I just kept going with that to actually create, you know, this army of little figures. They're all, every one of them, you know, has a different finish on them. And, you know, none of them are the same. It's the same basic thing, but, you know, they're the same but different. But the finish on all of them is different. You know, some are just oxides, some are glazes, some are, no finish on them, so it was a process of doing it.
Mm-hmm. Did you do those all at the same time? The same
no, that was I spent because it didn't really evolve into a thing until I maybe had like half a dozen of them, and that was maybe over the course of a month or something. Mm-hmm. And then you know it was just one of those things. Just kind of make a little mate for that. You've got a little ball clay here, whatever, and something complementary to it. And then it turned into, you know, something at one point, but it didn't start out to be anything, and it wasn't started or completed as a unit. You know, it was just came about.
Okay. Now there's some sort of relationship thing going on there.
Yeah, not much.
Like this one here. These are 3 months.
Yeah.
Yeah. So some of your concept is surrounded around religion, maybe some, can we pause it there? These guys are just kind of like facing in opposite directions as if there's three of them and they're all involved with their own introspection.
The direction of them was more for presentation. Mm-hmm. And my stuff does deal with religion and mythology, these guys are pretty introspective. Mm-hmm. They're you know they're together but they're apart. They're, you know they're rather solitary. That's just oxides of those.
I like the grouping of these. As one piece, mm-hmm. but they're not connected in any way, and you can position them as you like. Mm-hmm. But I do like the psychological balance that you have going there, you know, with them. Mm-hmm. I think they're pretty interesting. Now this piece here, is this one fit? This is not the one that fits together, or is this?
They meld together. I mean, they weren't, you know, consciously. You know, I didn't build one mm-hmm. onto the other one, but they kind of ended up being together.
Well, these are goats. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the one on the left actually is pieced together. I mean that's actually three pieces of uh-huh. pottery there, and the one on the left is formed from two pieces that were like built towards one another. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they're goats. There are lots of goats in my work.
Yeah, a couple of goats.
There's a lot of goats.
We'll get a good close up there. And you have a couple of rattles in here too, right? Mm-hmm. Like this piece here actually has a ball inside of it. I think they all do. And that when you pick them up and shake mm-hmm. them, they actually make a sound.
Mm-hmm.
And everything done by hand, nothing.
Yeah, everything's hand built.
Mm-hmm. Now this is what a sugar tower. You said it was called.
Mm-hmm.
What's the significance of that?
None. I keep building obelisks.
Mm-hmm.
Just to reference mythology and mm-hmm. Ancient Western history.
Now this one in particular.
There are two goats, no?
Got me. Is this the one? This is the Baphomet
for John Balance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I was you resurfaced a word to me that I hadn't seen for a long time, which was Baphomet, and that essentially is the term that is used for, say, the can we pause it on the tarot, for one, like it's a symbol, say, of what, of the devil, or does it have other meaning to you?
Well, no, I don't know what its relationship with tarot is, mm-hmm. but in Eastern mythology, and it slipped over into the West too at points. The Baphomet is a deity who takes the form of a goat or a ram, who isn't so much evil as one that embraces and tries to force chaos upon mm-hmm. humanity.
Right.
So it's not a
negative thing, you know.
It's more chaos based mm-hmm. and proposing entropy as mm-hmm. a solution rather than unity. In the West now we would think of him as being a personification or a goatification.
Ooh, okay.
If you will, of evil, but he's actually someone who a figure that embraces chaos and tries to introduce that into the order of our culture.
Right. So clear up that misconception of what, you know, people think of when they look at that was his Anton Wilson.
One of the things is, he's more about introducing chaos and uh-huh. and saying that's a natural force and we should respect that and
uh-huh.
say chaos and entropy are perhaps
a part of existence.
Yeah.
I mean, if we're going to be accepting all of this Eastern philosophy,
mm-hmm.
you know, in terms of yin and yang and all of that stuff, I mean, you have your positive and your negative as well, too, in Western philosophy, only it's different terminologies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I find that really interesting, you know, that you put that into your your play sculpture.
So well, the Baphomet and the goat correspondingly, you know, are interesting to me, and because I am intrigued with that idea of introducing chaos into, you know, order
mm-hmm.
and like what happens then. So yeah. I don't know.
It always seems there's some sort of fight going on between chaos, mm-hmm. and chaos versus order, that whole thing, even in, you know, in a contemporary art with painting in particular, you have somebody mm-hmm. using a splashing, you know, and slashing effects in paint, then you have somebody else using geometric straight edge
mm-hmm.
Painting with that, and then there's the artists out there that are combining the two, that are having straight edge, you know, mixed in with that, and they think that they're, you know, controlling the chaos and balancing the it seems to be getting too contrite, you know, after
mm-hmm.
you know 50 years of doing it. So, but it's just one of those themes inside of art that I just see reoccurring, is this order versus chaos, and that's pretty much it. Can we continue just for a little more? We have a few more pieces on here.
More goats.
Get your goat. Now this one here, what's the, I'm not remembering the title on this. What is?
That's 181 Buddhas.
181 Buddhas. So what is the, what is the meaning of 181 Buddhas?
That's just literally what it is. It's, I made a mold of, the tablet form in front of the obelisks, in front of the five obelisks, is a mold I made from a tablet which had Thai Buddhas on it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, numerous.
Mm-hmm.
It was a beautiful like thing for a home temple.
Mm-hmm.
For Buddha, and I made a mold of the actual tile, and then I made those from the mold, made the tablets, and then I counted up the Buddhas, because I was very imprecise about making, I didn't want an exact mold, you know. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to duplicate the thing, I wanted to make something that was the same but different.
Mm-hmm.
So I made the tablets, the arched tablets of the Buddhas, and then counted up how many I actually got. So I didn't, you know, I skipped a couple because I wasn't really good and precise about doing it because I didn't want to make duplicates. So then I counted up how many I actually got when I was done. I should have had a lot more, but I was sloppy about making them. That was kind of the point of making them. They were all done in different kinds of clay. And then the obelisks were made from a form I made. And so those were like press cast. And then they were all affixed to the obelisks.
Interesting work. Really
Thank
enjoyed
you.
Your show.
Thank you very much.
Oh, yes, that's right. We have these cups. Not actually intended to be cups. I believe they're just...
They actually hold water, though.
They do.
Can't believe
they
it. They're actually functional.
Mm-hmm.
Hard to believe. I could do that.
I like this one with the gap in it. I think that's really.
Everyone likes that one.
Mm-hmm.
That's the one everyone like is drawn to.
You know, see, this is. I think this is what it is about your work. It's just that it is so. For one, it's meaningful. It's eclectic. It's and it's interesting. And it's not something that you, I mean, even if you were to just pick it up and use it to drink water out of or coffee or whatever.
Well, I wouldn't do that. I use poisons in my stuff.
Oh, but it holds the water.
Yeah, it holds the water, but don't drink it. Because there are a lot of heavy metals in all those things.
Yeah. But they're
I'll make you one that you can drink it out of.
Oh, cool. Okay.
We'll see.
Yeah. If I dare, you know. You know that the what is it that a blowfish ruined in
oh yeah.
Yeah, you know, if you eat the
I don't know
you
if know, I
one out of 300 people
yeah.
die from eating it, right? So you know.
But if I was in Tokyo I'd go for it.
You'd probably go for
yeah.
it, yeah, you know. Yeah. Yeah. I see, I
only
know.
Live once.
I'll have the blowfish, please. Well, I think okay, we've hit the end of the disc there. But the I guess really what the point of all we're talking about here has to do with using this particular art form as more than functional, and show that you know that it's a growing art form, and that we have a lot of artists in the area that are taking advantage of this, that have actually been shying away from painting. I've been seeing more and more artists working in ceramic and mosaic, and it's you know becoming quite the thing. You know, the glass studio down at the Goggle Works has really burgeoned. There's a lot of people that are working in glass now too. So, you know, I just find it an interesting phenomenon. So I wanted to have you guys here to talk about that.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. Hey, but we only have a few minutes here, like maybe about what 5 minutes left or so. About final
Let's go
words.
To the phones.
Caller number one, please. Let's have. Okay. Okay. Thank you for your call.
We get a Baba Booey call.
Yeah, Bob. Oh, yeah.
New response.
Yeah. Right. You know. Okay. But I should call. I should call us on my own phone. You know. And, but Anyways, is there anything that you would like to say? Anything you'd like to...
I have no idea.
No idea.
What I want to say to you. I have no idea.
Well, what's...
Because I love what I do.
That's obvious. That's obvious. I can really see that.
That's why I don't get in the way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah. Well, that's one of the best things about that, too. It's not well thought out, you know? Mm-hmm. Or it is thought out, and I was going to say not well thought out. That's the wrong thing to say, but it would be, you know, that it's more coming from a place that isn't involved with your mind. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. But you're also a fan of things like meditation and...
I am. Well, I always think that I'm, you know, in a pretty good state of meditation when I'm in the middle of my work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just mindless.
Mm-hmm.
All I do is gather up the materials, and I don't even know what they are. I just need one form, one thing to start with, and... What else is going to come together? I have no idea. Like a sawhorse, you know. I had these sawhorses under my steps for over a year. They belonged to a friend. I had borrowed them. I tried to give them back. She wasn't coming for them. I kept asking her to come for them. And one day, I just, you know, because a horse, like your goats, horse is a recurring theme for me. I just looked at those darn things and I said, mm-hmm. they're horses, and I made them, and then I called her up and I said, too late.
Too late.
You can't happen that at this point. But, you know, so I had these sawhorses. What goes with it? I had other pieces of discarded wood, cover it up, decorate it, get out the glass.
Mm-hmm. And just do it.
Just do it.
Yeah. No. Really enjoy your work. Is there anything coming up for you? Going to be having any shows lately or something?
I'm
happening?
Getting ready for the Pennsylvania Glass Trail show at the Goggle Works in October. And then I do something with the Reading Hospital in November. And during that time period, I will again be in India.
Uh-huh. Going back to India.
I'm going back to, uh-huh. I think, I always think I know what I'm going to be doing when I get there, and then when I get there, it's completely different. So ask uh-huh. me when I get back what I did, but what uh-huh. I think I'm going to do is repair some uh-huh. Statues down south in the country at another a site that's been vandalized.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Say in my travels,
concrete
I'm going
and
on,
concrete, uh-huh. more concrete and mosaics.
Can you bring me some food back, please?
I'll try. I'll try.
Yeah, my biggest travels are going out to Oli or something.
Oli's pretty cool. Like one
yeah,
on out
place,
there.
Good place to be.
Yeah.
So, what's happening for you next?
I would like everyone to turn off your TiVos and DVRs and VCRs and destroy the tapes, because I'm stealing Nancy's ladder idea. That's the only thing in my offing. I'm stealing that idea like that. No, I'm just you know, keep on trucking.
Well, till the next thing happens, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't. We're busy down in Oley now, getting our act together down there.
Mm-hmm.
Down at Clay on Main, we're in the process of becoming a nonprofit, and that's exciting. So it's like
mm-hmm.
coming up with scheduling and stuff, and I'm down there working, and when I'm not there, I'm, you know.
Mm-hmm. So you're down there working with Elise Arnold and Dolores Kirshner.
Dolores Kirshner, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we've got a great bunch of people, and, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Working there or working down the street here.
At Robbie's.
Yeah,
studio.
Working with Rob Pepper.
A lot of things. Yep.
And yeah, keeping busy.
Mm-hmm.
Doing stuff.
Oh, that's great.
And, but I'm doing those ladders, man.
I can't wait to see them.
They'll be made of clay. So, well, let's see. What do we got? One more minute left. Just about okay. So, okay. Well, I would like to thank my guests. Okay, Nancy Segetti, Matthew Hamilton. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Come here.
No, I'm over here.
Oh, over there?
There you go.
There you go. Oh, now I'm embarrassed.
And thanks to James Carroll.
Yeah.
Yeah, wherever you are.
Thank you, James. Okay, and thank you. This is Ron Snyder for NAP Connections, and good night.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA, airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday, 10 to 2 p.m., or by appointment.